All team, give it everything you got.
It's time to fangirl flail with Fangirls Going Rogue.
Count me in.
Never get between a Mandalorian and a weapons package.
This is the way.
News, discussion, and commentary from the female point of view.
You call this a diplomatic solution?
No, I call it aggressive negotiations.
She's as important as he is.
With your hosts, Tricia Barr and Sarah Woloski.
Boy, am I glad to hear your voice.
Strap in, because this is where the fun begins.
I like the sound of that.
Welcome to a new episode of Fangirls Going Rogue. I'm Tricia Barr, one of your co-hosts, and with me, as always, is one of my best friends in the Force, Sarah Woloski. How you doing, Sarah?
I am doing good, and I'm excited to talk Bad Batch because we just had some amazing episodes come out today.
And you know what? These episodes, that it was a two-part today, which was fun. To get a little bit more. I was so waiting, because we've seen this a while ago, but I was so waiting to get here because I was looking forward to the reactions, and I had major thoughts when I saw them, and I'm so glad that people sort of responded to the same things, and we're going to talk about those things in this episode. It's going to be, there's so much meat to talk about, and I'm excited to go there. But first, we have to wish Sarah a happy birthday, and also Teresa, our former co-host, who helped Fangirls Going Rogue. You guys are twinsies on the birthday.
Same day, March 10th, 4 years apart. But yes, it's very exciting. I am the elder statesman.
And did you have a good birthday?
I had an incredibly amazing birthday. It happened to be this year on the Oscars day, and I didn't realize that until I had scheduled like a gathering of some of my best friends to come over, and I wish you could have been there too, Tricia. You would have had a blast. But one of my friends couldn't come because they were like, oh, we do an Oscars party every year. I was like, oh, is my birthday on the Oscars? And it was. And it's just so sad how, like, I don't pay attention to that anymore. Because back in the 90s, I was, like, so into the Oscars.
Oh, me. I, like, turn on the red carpet and watch the interviews. Laverne Cox does it on E! News. And she is so good on the red carpet, like, just asking these questions. And it's so much fun. I, like it's just kind of like chill out day for me. Watch all the beautiful ladies in their beautiful dresses. America Ferrera killed it.
Her pink gown.
Give me that right now. I know it's like chain mail and it's probably unattainable for any of us, but like I guess they went through all this stuff to get the perfect pink. And if we're going to go with the Barbie thought, the I am Ken. What is
yes.
That?
Yes, was like I'm just Ken.
I'm da, just da, da, Ken. Da.
Anywhere it else, won. I'd be a 10. Yeah,
it won everything. It won, in my mind, it won the Oscars. I don't care who voted for what. That won the Oscars with the Mandy Moore choreographed it.
That was so fun. I have a question though. So Emily Blunt had this dress with like straps that came like above her shoulders, and I don't understand what was up with that.
That actually is a nod to a certain designer's couture. It's meant to do that, and it's meant to evoke like a breastplate as opposed to, it's intentional. And there were some other people who walked on red carpets previous to, Florence Pugh's also did the same kind of thing. It had its own rigidity, but it's intentional. And I had the same thought. I kept looking at it all night, but it's supposed to be that way.
Okay. I figured because when I saw her sitting, I was like, oh, maybe it's because she's sitting. But then she came up and presented and it was still doing that. So I was like, oh, okay.
I mean, come on. Emily and Florence are like icons. So yeah. I didn't figure they were messing it up. That's why I kind of worked on. But I mean, to our eyes, it's like, why is it doing that?
Yeah. I was just curious, but I knew you'd have some sort of answer.
Me, like I turn on Entertainment Tonight on Monday after the Oscars and you got to watch the stuff about just the whole fashion stuff. So I'm like totally into the looks and how hard they go. I wish they wouldn't have to worry about being super thin, because that felt like a theme this year, that everybody was on Ozempic. But
yeah, it's always that way. Yeah. But regardless, I ended up watching a lot of it on YouTube, like just the best clips, because for the night we watched Clueless and had a great time watching Clueless just with a like about 10 people. We were laughing our asses off. It was perfect. It's the best movie.
Perfect girl get together movie. Perfect. Yeah.
Yeah. It was great. But now we get to talk about The Bad Batch, and it has been just our last episode, we only talked about the first three, the premiere. So this time we are going to go into four episodes. So we have episode 304, A Different Approach, episode 305, The Return, and then today's two-parter, episode 306, Infiltration, and 307, Extraction. So we're going to go through each of these four and just give a little bit of our reactions to it, and then we're going to delve deep into the topics you guys love to hear us talk about, which is music, storytelling, and character studies. Okay, so are we ready for this?
I'm ready.
Okay, so why don't you give us the breakdown for A Different Approach, episode 304.
Episode 304, Omega and Crosshair are stranded on planet Lao and must gamble to get money to smuggle themselves out of the spaceport without chain codes. But when Batcher is snatched by Imperial troopers, they finally do it Crosshair's way and blast their way out of the spaceport. Rendezvous with Hunter and Wrecker concludes the episode. Get yourself your tissues.
Yes, yes. Okay, so what was your immediate reaction to this episode?
To me, this is a little bit of a slower episode. I kind of knew where it was going, but we even talked about this on the Fangirls Going Rogue Zoom chat. I feel like it's there, it's animation, it's meant to teach younger people about storytelling beats. So I was willing to forgive that for the emotional payoff at the end and the things it did with Omega and Crosshair's relationship.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, the very A Different Approach is kind of what they talk about. The whole crux of the episode hinges on Omega is taking charge in this one, because Crosshair has just been a prisoner. And so she is trying any way she can to get out of that spaceport without blasting away at people and making a scene. So she turns to something that she learned from Sid's parlor and turns to gambling. And meanwhile, Crosshair the whole time is like, every minute we stay here, every minute we stay, we are more in danger, and we need to blast our way out. And so I mean, my favorite moment in the episode was when they're just pinned in the spaceport, in where all the animals are in the crates, and it's just not working. They're about to be captured, and Omega's like, fine, we'll do it your way. And Crosshair just has this amazing, finally, and just brings out his gun like Rocket Raccoon, getting everyone. And they blast their way out of the spaceport.
So, it's perfect for that. I mean, I think Omega's going to be a leader. And part of being a leader is finally accepting what path you need to go on, and that maybe the person on your team that's been advocating for that path might be the right person. That you're not always going to have the answers as the leader. And he let her take that leader role. I think it was showing us something about his character. He doesn't want to be a leader, right?
Yeah, and he's always been kind of in the background, and I can understand that.
Yeah, and he feels like maybe he's a lesser person right now. That's just like his emotional state. And sometimes you can be in an emotional state where you just want somebody to be in charge. We've all been there, right? You don't want to make decisions. You don't want to be the one who's making the calls. You're just insecure about it. That's normal to be in that place for everybody at some point in your life. And I felt like when he it gave him a boost for her to say, yes, let's do it your way.
That's a great way to put that. I also think that this episode gave me a clue rewatching this episode, because as you said, we've watched all these episodes back in February, but rewatching this episode, I had always been thinking, okay, why don't Crosshair and Omega know where Mount Tantus is? They just came from Mount Tantus on a ship. They should know kind of the vicinity of where it is. But in this episode, at the very beginning, when they crash land on Lao, there's a line that Omega says. She's like, oh, the navigation computer is fried. I can't get the coordinates to Tantus. So there you go. That was my answer that I didn't remember hearing when I first saw it. It's like, okay, that's how they don't really know where Tantus is, because the navigation system just kind of brings you through planets and places that they don't, you know about safely, basically. So, or through a hyperspace lane that, you know, that a human person could not calculate on their own.
I want you to talk about, because we talked about this off the air, about kind of you building on the idea of me seeing this as the Return of the Jedi the show. Can you just talk about that?
So ever since you said that, I've been watching these episodes with an eye to that, because it really is fascinating. And so this episode really speaks to what George Lucas was trying to get across in Return of the Jedi, which is the whole nature versus technology. You have the Ewoks. They use logs to fight. They use spears. They use sticks. They just use things that they have made with their hands. And they are taking down this technological empire that has all the might and money behind it. And yet they're taken down by little Ewoks. And so this episode is mimicking that in the spaceport, because you have Omega and Crosshair, and it's when they finally release the animals, nature, that is helping them escape against technology and the spaceport being locked down.
I mean, it was a different way of them showing the way that the Empire strips natural resources. In this case, they're stripping it of animals, or trafficking them through their whatever. We don't know, but that's just the implication of their, like, gathering these animals. And I just love that the guy gets eaten by a Rathtar.
Yes. So, it's the best. I mean, that's definitely what I thought it was, a Rathtar. I know some people were questioning, but I was like, no, it's a Rathtar.
I think it's a Rathtar. You know, they're kind of cool animals. They're, you know, it was one of the fun things from the Force Awakens, right? It was fun. So I was like, okay, he got eaten by a Rathtar. Let's just go. Very Jurassic Park. I loved it when you mentioned that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. All right, anything else you want to add about a different approach?
No, but I do want to talk about episode 305, The Return, because The Outpost is one of my favorite episodes from season 2. And we went back there. I was shocked when I saw that. I was like, wow, we're going back to one of my favorite places. It was such a huge emotional turning point for Crosshair. And in this episode, so we return to the outpost, and without tech, they need to find a way to figure out, to get some information. And without tech, like, the obvious answers aren't there anymore. So the Batch visits the remote outpost to gather encrypted Imperial data. Things don't go well. There's a big snow worm, and we end up with a lot of brotherly fighting.
Yes, but also because they face danger, I feel like we end up with some brotherly coming together.
They needed it.
Yeah. Yeah, they did. But I thought, like, this whole episode is based on the fact that they don't have tech anymore. It's so sad. And so in order to find the data that's on Omega's or Lamassu, is it Lamassu? No. Nalase's iPad, for better lack of a word. They have to go to the outpost, which Crosshair knows is very remote, and there's not a lot of guards. So it's like, okay, well, if we're going to go anywhere, let's go there. I loved this too. I loved the return of the Ice Vulture, which is Crosshair's spirit animal, much like Ahsoka has the Convor. So I thought that was really neat. And it's hard for me because the next two episodes, Infiltration and Extraction, were so good, but The Return, I think, is my favorite because of what you said. Two reasons. Because of what you said, it harkens back to The Outpost, which again is my favorite episode of last season. And it's like total Jurassic Park references all over the place. And it was just so funny when, you know, they finally plug in the iPad, but then the power goes down because too much power is being used. It's being sucked up. And this is very similar to Jurassic Park when all of a sudden the power goes out on all the perimeter fences. And so they need to turn the power back on in both of this, Jurassic Park and the Return. And so immediately when Omega's like, uh-oh, power's not here. Someone needs to go to the bunker and like redo the power supply, like turn it up back on. And I was like, oh my god, Jurassic Park. And so when Wrecker went over there, and of course there's a deadly creature on the loose too, right? Just like in Jurassic Park, you got the dinosaurs. Well, here you got the worms. And so when Wrecker goes to the bunker and starts like pumping the pump, like 2, 1, 2. If he does it 3 times, this is Jurassic Park reference, and he did it 3 times. And Richard and I were like laughing our asses off on the couch. Like, oh my god, it's Jurassic Park. So it was so fun. And even because, you know, part of that returning the power supply back on in Jurassic Park is rebooting the perimeter fences. Well, yep. Here they have to turn on the perimeter fence to keep the worm out. So it was a very similar situation.
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of nostalgia in the episode as far as hearkening back to classic things in science fiction storytelling. Mm-hmm. Because we have Dune, so we have a snow worm instead of a sandworm. And for people who don't know, Dune is actually before Star Wars as a story. And George Lucas was definitely inspired by Dune. So it all kind of feels like it works. But just the whole way that going to the outpost forced Crosshair to tell some, like, he suggested it because in his mind, he's like, we need the information. I know the way to do it. And that's part of being the Bad Batch, right? Is you figure out things and you get it done. Maybe unconventional. But in going there, he had to confront. The biggest question is, like, how did you get in prison? Mm-hmm. How did you end up, you know, I'm sure they're all wondering, is he like an Imperial spy? Is he been planted? But he's like, no, I like, finally came to the same truth that you guys knew before me that I was resistant to, which is I'm disposable and I don't want to be part of this. And Crosshair did the most personal and violent thing you can do about that, was just murder somebody. Not that he didn't have it coming to him, that new lieutenant, but it ended up with him being taken to Mount Tantus.
Yeah, such a cool episode. And here I feel like Hunter saw what Crosshair was doing. Like, Crosshair took the helmet of the trooper that he had tried to bring back safely to the base and lost, and the other two of his clone brothers. And Hunter saw that and he said, you know, I think that spoke a lot more than words could have to him.
Oh, for sure. It's all the like the little subtle things that they're noticing. I mean, obviously they've given him back his gear now, so he's back in the, you know, the Bad Batch gear, but he has to like learn to rewear it and be part of the team. And Hunter, that moment when he says, like, you're the one who lost Omega and you didn't find her, I did. Oh, I mean,
yeah,
it cuts to the truth of it, but, you know, making Hunter see the truth of kind of where his self is, you know, they're all kind of, you know, Wrecker's just, he's the big brother. He's just happy the gang's back together. It's Hunter and Crosshair who have to find their peace with each other.
Definitely. All right. Should we head to Infiltration? All right, here, this is episode 6, Infiltration. and a clone X is captured during an attack on Senator Chuchi and taken back to Rex's base. A threat to Omega is discovered, and the Bad Batch are brought to Teth in an attempt to gain more insight into the location of Tantus. A new clone X is assigned to kill his captured colleague, yikes, and discovers Omega's presence at the base, alerting Hemlock's forces. Dun, dun, dun. Whew, okay, so what were your initial impressions on this one?
I think if you're a Clone Wars fan, you were served in this episode, in the next two episodes. And that's why when I mentioned at the top of the show, I was so excited to kind of see where people would react to this.
Yeah.
Just because we see Commander Wolf, we get to go back to Rex's purpose, kind of where he is, and see him as a leader. And there was, you know, just all the other little clones that are involved in this, to see them in this resistance as opposed to being the conquering force that they were born to be. It was just really kind of, I don't know, it really kind of sets the whole clone story, all of the clones, into the Bad Batch.
You know, jumping off that, like, leading into this series, you know, we both weren't that excited about it. It was like clones, it was war. I'm not really into war movies, I'm not into battles and things like that. But this series has really turned me around, not only because Omega, but at the beginning of this episode, I loved the show of the clones just being excellent at their jobs. This is what they're built for. This is what they have done their whole lives. They are masters. So like when Clone X tries to take out the senators, the three clone protectors, you know, they have him captured in a matter of minutes just by using, oh, hey, he's on the roof. He's heading for this sentry. It's like so badass. I loved it so much. And then later when Clone X infiltrates the base and he has them cornered in that cell with the other Clone X, the clones just work together without even having to talk. Like Wrecker immediately lays down cover fire because he knows the others can then escape into the main room and like get more positions, and just each of them have kind of their job that they don't need to talk to each other about. They just know. And I thought that was amazing, and it really changed my perspective on the clones.
It's about being capable, right? And just trusting each other to be capable in the moment. But it's cool to see. I kind of felt like Rex was operating more kind of like a secret service agent, which isn't that far removed from being a trained soldier. It's just that they're using their skills to protect somebody and defend somebody as opposed to kill somebody, which is what they were taught to do. So it's a neat way to show that they're using their skills for good. I mean, ultimately, Rex is in the resistance, so he's still going to have to fight.
Contrary to that, you have the Clone X, which are completely dehumanized by their look. I mean, their helmet itself has like a snout, makes them look animalistic and not at all like a human. So, and it's just so creepy looking, but they do a good job in that design.
I love it. I love the look of the Clone X, just for exactly the reason you're saying. It's like you have nothing, right? The clones all have their identifying thing, and you could take one Clone X and you replace it with the next Clone X, and you shouldn't be able to tell the difference. It's essentially like that one got captured and he somehow didn't get killed, but he's got a tag in him and we can find him and do what we're gonna do.
And they tag him just like animals, right?
Exactly. Like a pet with a microchip.
Absolutely. Wow. And I just want to note that there's a trooper here named Nemec, which if you're a fan of Andor, you have Nemec, the boy who, you know, unfortunately died in the I episode. But yeah, I was like, oh, it's Nemec. And it almost looked like he died too, but I think he made it to the next episode, Extraction.
I know. There was quite a few. I was like, it's not good. Rex is having his troops wiped out again.
Yeah.
And he brings it up right when he runs into Wolf in the next episode. But, you know, he's got his crew. He has his purpose, which I think is really important to establish that he and the clones that are with him have their purpose, right? Mm-hmm. They know what they want to do right now, which is free their brothers. And I like that. I think it was Hauser who's the one who told him, you need to call the Bad Batch here. You need to get Hunter here. Mm. You need to talk to Crosshair. And I think Rex knew that, but it was maybe someplace he didn't want to go yet. And so it felt like it was almost like Rex talking to himself, even though it was another clone voicing the things that he knew he needed to do, but maybe didn't want to do.
Yeah, that makes sense. And then at the end, was it at the end of this episode that we see that there are some, basically an army battalion on its way to retrieve, not retrieve Clone X, but to like capture Omega, because at this point they know that Omega is there. And that's the reveal you get of the Wolf armor. So I know a lot of clone fans were probably like going, oh my God, it's Wolf. And I was like, wait, that looks like a Wolf. I didn't know it was Commander Wolf myself. I just knew it was one of the Wolf pack, you know, guys. But yeah, I'm not so good with armor, but I know a lot of the guys are.
The one other thing about this episode is the title, because we've talked a lot about titles and who actually is doing the infiltrating in this episode.
Well, it's not the Bad Batch, which initially when I saw these titles and we didn't see, you know, the episodes at all, you'd think that they were going to like infiltrate Mount Tantus, right? And then have to extract Omega. But no, it's the other way around. Someone is infiltrating them. It's like the Clone X dude. Right.
Yeah. And so I'm just making that point because when you talk about the story of the clones now, and they call the Clone X operative the Shadow. Oh. And in storytelling, Campbell's model, the Shadow is the character, you know, Anakin Skywalker is the Shadow, right? He's the bad side of the story in the original trilogy. And so this character is the Shadow is infiltrating the kind of the safe space of the clone resistance, like the place where they're trying to form their new identity, right? That's what Rex trying to do, is trying to form a new identity to save the brothers. So it's very interesting that this is about the Shadow, which is replaceable, that it can just, you can just keep, they can just keep popping them out, is infiltrating their story and their journey.
That's interesting you say that. And it sounds like, I mean, we get little hints throughout these two episodes that Crosshair was, they were trying to get Crosshair to be a Clone X. Like he was along the path somehow.
I'm going to totally plug Hyperspace Theories at this point because it's going to be out by the time we're up. BJ and I did a rewatch of the end of season 2. And the last scene is Omega goes into a room and sees Crosshair on Mount Tantus. And he's in a room with all these other clones. And they're in something that looks like a procedure has happened to them. And there's clones in kind of the tubes. I think of Rise of Skywalker, you know, when you see like the tubes and you wonder about where, you know, what they're doing with the cloning and stuff, but you see these tubes. And so I'm wondering if that's the moment, because it does get brought up, is that the place that they were actually trying to do the conversion, right? Or not? I don't know. But it was one of the things I was like, I think I know more about this moment now that I've seen 8 episodes of The Bad Batch season 3 when I rewatched the end of season 2.
And I remember some scenes, like I haven't watched it as recently as you, but I remember some scenes in season 2 where I think Crosshair was like on a examination table being plugged with a needle, and like what's his name? Bad guy would come in and like check on him.
Yeah. So Hemlock was trying to get information about okay. because he had been told that Nala Se's kind of like currency was what's happening with Omega. So they were interrogating him at that point. But then we learned that they tried to turn him into a clone X and he was defective and it didn't work on him. Right. So, yeah. So he's had a lot done to him at this point. And then probably had his blood drawn every day, like all yeah. of them have, to get tested.
Yeah. So, I mean, he could, I don't believe it, but he could possibly be another shadow or a shadow of a shadow at this point. And that's what some of the other clones are kind of leery about. I think it was it Hauser or Scorch?
Rightfully. Yeah. Rightfully.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Hauser was the clone in the Ryloth episodes who finally decided that this was not the right thing. And so Hauser's the right character sort of question Crosshair on where his allegiance lies.
Got it. Got it. And that has changed, at least from what we see.
Episode 307, Extraction, trying to escape Imperial troopers intent on capturing Omega. Rex and the Bad Batch cross paths with Commander Wolf and the Wolf Pack. Crosshair tries to protect Omega and earn the trust of Rex's followers as they flee the base into the jungle. The mysterious clone X almost kills Crosshair, but is washed over a waterfall when a clone trooper comes to Crosshair's aid. Echo and Gregor arrive as Rex's team is face-to-face with Commander Wolf. Rex reminds Wolf that they are chasing a child for the Empire, and Wolf stands down and allows Rex and the others to escape with Echo.
That was so surprising. I was kind of surprised that the other stormtroopers didn't, like, say anything about that, but I guess they're all in the chain of command thing. Yeah. I don't know.
It makes sense to me that some of the clone troopers were designed to follow orders. Mm. And so they're still on their instinct level. Like nothing in there. They don't have any information to question what they're doing. And Wolf and Rex are more like peers. And it's a really powerful thing for a character like Rex, instead of trying to fight his way out of the situation, tries to negotiate. He tries to adopt a diplomatic solution to the problem he's in because he doesn't want to kill his fellow clones. He doesn't want to fight with them. And the thing he does instead is offer a solution. And it's really powerful moment too, that the Bad Batch, he says, like, put your guns down, and they respond to him. So what that says about Rex is just incredible, like, as, like, the leader of this resistance.
Yeah, very true. That was exciting. I also love the fact, you know, here we do see it's Commander Wolf. It's like, okay, I was right. But then my mind immediately goes to Rebels because, you know, in their retirement RV, you have Rex, Wolf, and Gregor. And Gregor wasn't here, but mm-hmm. here is like this meeting of Rex and Wolf. And okay, so who else got chills when Wolf said, oh, I thought you died. You know, I heard mm-hmm. a bunch of, you know, you guys, the ship fell down out of the sky and crashed. It's like, oh, I got chills just remembering that entire episode of the finale of Clone Wars. Like, oh my God.
It's right there kind of in the feels.
Yeah.
Just the whole episode. And in this case, the extraction is the extraction of the Rex's group, as opposed to when we were talking about the infiltration, was different. But when you think about, when you thought about it, when you looked at the titles, like you said, you thought, oh, they're going to Mount Tantus, probably, just assuming, and you're guessing and pondering, and then they'll get extracted. But it's not what we thought it was. But still, again, powerful for Crosshair in this episode. And we're going to talk about that more.
Yes.
But one of the interesting things was, you know, they did that, the escape down the spiral. And I talk a lot about characters going up and down staircases. Oh. You know, if you watch Marvel movies, or go down things or up things. And in this case, Crosshair had done the season two episode, remember where he was such a good shot? And,
and he like could fire things off mirrors and hit someone.
And he doesn't do that this time. And so he was trying to help their escape. And I think if he had been perfectly able as he had been, that would have been a no-brainer that he would have taken out Clone X. So to me, that's like, why did they set that up in the story? I don't know. But
why did they set up going down the spire?
Well, they're going down the spiral, but that he didn't kill that particular clone, which we will talk about also. Okay. But it's just, so the whole episode, there was just so many powerful lines in it too. In this episode, the clone, Rex says to Wolf, "I am asking you to do the right thing," right? And that's the whole thing about being a clone right now, is determining what the right thing is, because they don't know what it is.
Right.
And
they've been lied to their whole lives, basically.
Yes. And then putting that kind of encapsulation for Hauser, right? And him talking to Crosshair and realizing that they're both in the same boat, and that the right thing for Hauser is to accept that Crosshair just got to the same conclusion he did a little bit later in his journey. And so these are all like self-determination things that the clones really didn't have in the Clone Wars too much. But the Jedi did teach him a little bit about that. So there are lessons that are learned by the Jedi and paying it forward.
Definitely. Yeah, there's a lot of powerful things. I don't want to bring some up until we talk about Crosshair, because there are some good lines there. Is there anything else you want to bring up about this episode?
I do want to talk about just the Clone X operative.
Okay.
Because these two episodes, we finally get to be there. And I'm going to tell you what my gut reaction was watching this before everybody else watched it, with Noah. You know, we watch them as screeners and we can't really talk to anybody. We can't really, but just my gut reaction. There were things about the second Clone X, that's who we're talking about, the one that comes in to kill, you know, I made the point of he didn't get killed by Crosshair.
And he almost killed Crosshair. He almost drowned Crosshair.
And they get in this huge battle that's very personal, right? Mm-hmm. And there were just little things about the way he spoke, about the way he moved his I don't know what they call that on his helmet, where he'd move it up and down, that reminded me of Tech. Tech moving his goggles and the way that helmet is. And
what? No, I don't want him to be Tech.
And the way he didn't follow orders. And there were things. And that character kept falling when he had the Crosshair shot at him and he fell down in the stairwell and then he fell down the waterfall. I'm like, are they totally trolling us? Like, is this like Tech finally reimagined as this like soulless operative, and they sucked his brain out? But then I do have hope, because Crosshair said it didn't work on him. But
that's terrible.
That was my first inclination. Okay, so now I'm going to tell you what my husband said when he saw it the first time, because I always like how people come to things differently. The episode ended and he said, "I think that's Cody."
Oh, Commander Cody, who actually did try to kill, right? Was it Cody the one?
Cody was in season two, they had that whole episode with in front of the wall of all the clone dead on Coruscant with Crosshair. And then Rampart implied that he disappeared. And people, I think, presume that he left to go to the Resistance.
Okay.
To go with Rex's team, but we haven't seen him with Rex. And then my husband said, "Well, I think he got sent to Tantus and got reprogrammed." And since then, they have the knife. Yes. I will say that somebody pointed out on Reddit, and I don't remember who, that Cody had a knife that he used in some episode.
Okay. Wow, so that's interesting.
There's another possibility. Did you have, like, any... Did you see it and go, is he somebody?
So... I didn't really have that thought just because he is so dehumanized. But after watching this, like, what, three times now, I feel like he could also, and that whole fight with Crosshair was personal. And the fact that Crosshair saw that initial clone X and was like, whoa, we need to, like, go. Like, I feel like it could be some kind of Crosshair clone.
Like, that's, I know, been you, out there too. Yeah. That's another.
But initially, I didn't have a question about who it was. I've only ever heard bits and pieces, so I don't have a hat in the ring, a horse in the race at this point.
And to be fair, I don't have a horse in the race either, but I like that it could be so many possibilities and that people are talking about it. But one of the things that we did...
Wait a minute. It could be, if someone finally kills it, what if green mist comes up from it?
Well, we do know ASAJJ is going to show up and somehow. So if it happened, I wouldn't be shocked. I would not be shocked in the least.
I'm just kidding. But we, that would be funny. We do know that
one of the reasons the Bad Batch was defective, deemed defective, is because they had personalities. And I'm going back to your point where you said they seem kind of dehumanized. What if they finally figured out the pieces of the best part that they want, not the best part, but the best part the Empire wants for these clones, like that they're sharpshooters or snipers like Crosshair, and they're techie because this clone X like is always tapping on his tech, and they essentially have to operate on their own and operate the ship and do all the things. So what if they have got the best parts of what they think is of the Bad Batch and finally perfected the part of them just not having a personality that would change them?
Maybe they that's could have why, done that.
Yeah, maybe that's why we all see bits of Crosshair and we see bits of Tech and we see bits of Cody in the character is another possibility.
Yeah, I think, honestly, I think that's probably the most likely, just because what has Hemlock been doing this whole time? He's definitely working on stuff. He definitely has a whole Mount Tantus operation. So he's definitely succeeded in some of his experiments. So in order to keep that funding going, right? So I see that as probably the most likely.
Yeah, interesting. It's a big mystery that's fun. Yeah. I don't, like, if it doesn't go one way or the other, I'm not going to be crushed. It's just something that I really like looking for the clues and I can appreciate as a fan. I'm like, ooh, I want to look at all the different ways that he operates. But I'm going to say that my initial gut reaction was Tech.
And you want that noted.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I hope it's not Tech. Not my tech, not our tech.
Yeah, I didn't know how I felt about it, but I was like, dude, he keeps falling down things. And then obviously he falls down the waterfall and then I figured, well, that's the end of that clone. And then they showed him again. I'm like, okay, maybe my little spidey senses weren't wrong on this.
Yeah, they made sure to show him scrabbling up the rock. It's like, okay, he survived. All right. Wow. All right, well... You guys ponder that. I want to hear what everyone thinks. So, you know, everyone, make sure you write to us or post on our social media. Who do you think Clone X is? All right. So, should we get into Crosshair?
I think so.
Okay. This is your big topic you wanted to discuss. So, why don't you lead off?
Yeah, it's one of those things, right? People always say Star Wars is about redemption. And it's a really complicated thing. This is, as somebody who came from Catholic, I taught CCD. I went to CCD.
Oh, wow. Really?
Oh, yeah. So
I went to CCD too.
I took courses in college about the Old Testament and the New Testament. We had a divinity school at Duke that was a very good divinity school. So these ideas, like, embedded in me, and I've always kind of struggled with Star Wars. That in the end, it seemed like so easy, right? Darth Vader, not easy, but it was, he's redeemed. He makes his choice at the end of the original trilogy. But what if he had to live? Like, what if he had to learn to earn people back? What if he had to try to convince Leia that all these things happened and this is where I ended up? And I feel like Crosshair sort of explores that idea. And actually, Star Wars sort of taught us the reverse idea, which is that there's redemption. And really, redemption is the end of atonement. Oh. And in this story, we're seeing it more happen, is in that Crosshair is going through an atonement journey through the different characters that he's interacting with that are making him reflect on the choices he's made, mm-hmm. and to earn their trust back, and to maybe ultimately redemption, in the kind of religious sense, at least for being a Catholic, and I think it's pretty close in most Christianities, is that you're paying a toll, a cost, and you know, they teach that Jesus is paying the ultimate cost, right? To end in that. But redemption is the end of the process. Mm. And Star Wars sort of has people, it sort of truncated the atonement process right out of the story, because they're films and you can't really do atonement stories in films unless you do, I don't know, 18 films.
Yeah. Yeah, it's why Leia had such a hard time when it got out that her father was Darth Vader, because Darth Vader never atoned for being Darth Vader. He just died.
Exactly.
Before he could do that.
Exactly. And to her credit, in fairness, even in the story, in the book, she didn't really want to forgive him, and she didn't, right? She didn't owe him that. You don't owe someone forgiveness, but people can try to make right the wrongs they've done. And Crosshair seems to be doing that very slowly. And over the course of these episodes, by one person at a time, right? You can only do it one person at a time. So Omega's the first, mm-hmm. right?
She's just a forgiving person. She's always very positive. We talked with, you know, Michelle Ang about this, how Omega's just such a positive person. So she is always wanting to see the good in people. And mm-hmm. so I think she never lost sight of the good in Crosshair. And so it was so much easier for her to forgive him.
Yeah, and that probably helps, right, for him, because it's the first step to kind of like, come on, you can go on this journey. That's kind of what the character is there for. And we mentioned it earlier, Wrecker seems like he's a big brother. He's closer to Omega in that sort of mindset of, I just want the gang back together and I don't really want to hold a grudge. And he brings out the suit and the armor to bring him back into the Bad Batch. But Hunter, for a lot of reasons, being the leader, he should be the cautious one. And I think that was that episode, right? That was a big deal
the outpost. No, not the outpost. Return. The return.
Yeah, to earn it back, and mm-hmm. to sort of, you know, them to kind of have to not come to fisticuffs, as Echo is like, oh, they didn't draw any blood this time.
Yeah, that was funny.
But I like how that's one step. And then his next step is Hauser, and kind of looking at that. And Hauser actually says that the respect is earned because he observes how Crosshair treats Omega, right?
Yes.
And he treats somebody else. And I think Hunter noticed how Crosshair paid his respect to the helmets mm-hmm. in that planet. And Crosshair chose to be honest with Hauser instead of, that's Crosshair just like engaging in conversation isn't normal.
Yeah, well, here you brought up that there's some excellent lines in this extraction episode. And, you know, Hauser is noticing, you know, Crosshair talking to Omega, and Hauser's like, you've changed. And this is where Crosshair basically says what he learned on the outpost, which is loyalty meant something to me. And I realized how disposable I was to the Empire is the implication there. And he just says it right out. Like, if you didn't get that from the outpost, well, there it is. There's his change, right?
Yeah. And so I just appreciate the way that through Crosshair we get to kindly finally see the what if he lived, or the notion of what if Ben Solo had lived past the sequel trilogy? Like, mm-hmm. what if he had to
atone,
face people and earn their trust back? Like, to me, that is an interesting story to be told, because in some ways, Star Wars kind of gives you an out of, you can just, you know, just do all these bad things and then you do one good thing and it's all good, right? We all were smiling. Anakin's at the fire. He gets to be a Force ghost. It's all good. And I actually think Ahsoka is dealing with that a little bit. I actually think Ahsoka is a little bit about Anakin atoning in some ways for the things he's done.
Okay. But
Crosshair gets to, his character gets to do it even more.
Yeah. I really like the line in Extraction where, you know, Crosshair really, I mean, part of that atonement is the deeds done rather than what you say. And there's a moment where, you know, the sniper's on them, Clone X is on them, and Crosshair's like, well, I have an idea. I'm going to go after them, draw his fire. And Omega on the comms is like, I don't really like that idea. And he's like, too bad. Just very gruff, but like I'm doing this. And he's basically sacrificing himself, drawing the fire so that the rest of them can escape.
Yeah, that's he thinks that's the role he needs to play. That's the step he needs to take. And if he doesn't make it out, D. Bradley Baker was talking about Tech's choice, right?
Yeah.
That Tech's death is earned, right? Mm-hmm. It was a worthy death for him. And I think Crosshair's in the same mentality, right?
Yes.
That if I have to go in service of these people, I would do that. I would give it freely. And that's where he wasn't before.
Yeah. You're making me I'm going to cry.
I know. Crosshair, the grumpy bald vulture, is making us all sobby. Who would have thought?
Right? Amazing. They do just great character work on TV shows. I love it. Wow. Anybody who thinks that animation is not as high of an art form as live action, I don't understand them anymore.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's talk about some amazing animation in the form of water.
I want to talk about this because we've been talking about this.
Well, you're the one who brought it up first in our previous episode.
You noticed the water in the first episode, the drips, right?
We keyed into it.
Just going back to the basics, right? They were born on a water planet.
Clones are, yes.
And that's their home. And the first episode of season two, we see them in a kind of bright, sunny setting on a beach. So they return to water. And you can go to the other episodes. Pabu is the place that they feel safe.
And it's mostly a water, Mediterranean climate planet.
Exactly. They were like, what seems like a peaceful, comforting place? We'll do space Santorini, essentially. If you've ever been to Greece, right? The Greek Isles. You'll know what I'm talking about. But that's essentially what they did.
You've seen Mamma Mia.
Exactly. Right there. But as I was watching these episodes, and I asked the question, I didn't really get an answer to it because I feel like I was a little close to home on this one. But you have the water drops, the drops of blood, and Sarah, you and Richard followed up on that question.
Yes.
The two drops of the water in the cell in episodes 1-3, ending with the blood dropping in.
Yeah, it's like two drops of blood of Omega's blood. It's
like
water, life, blood, life, water, Omega. Yeah.
So we kind of picked up on
you that. Know what? Hold on. Water cycle. The cycle of water. You have, well, and then, okay, so let's keep moving
Moana,
on.
Because you haven't been to Moana's journey into water at Epcot yet, but you could really go into the cycle of water.
Yeah, because water is, you know, in the form of, it's water or it's frozen, you know, so
it's
solid, it's evaporating,
it's
a gas,
goes into the clouds,
it's liquid. Yeah.
Rains, gives life, goes back to the rivers, the oceans, and goes back up. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I think that's like eighth grade.
It's like the blood centrifuge, too.
Earth science or something.
Yeah.
We did pay attention in school, middle school.
Uh-huh.
We're good. And then we went to, I went to Moana Journey of Water.
Yes.
Someday Sarah will go to it because it's really cool. Mm-hmm. But in episode 4, you'd be like, there's not much water. There's a dusting of snow on that planet that they land on. But I think the most important reference visually to water is that they made the choice to show their breath. When you breathe out and you see, you know, the breath and cold air, that's actually water changing as you breathe out. It's water's coming out of your body, and they show it over and over again.
Batcher, they're cold too.
Yeah,
yeah, it's a cold planet. You see that breath. That was cool. Like, and in fact, we watched that episode right after we had recorded, and you mentioned water, and I'm like, oh look, it's the frozen breath. It's water.
Exactly. And so once you start looking at it, you're like, And for them, character wise, what it says to me is that they're in this place of danger. They're kind of on the border of life and death, because that episode, if they don't escape, there's a lot of peril, particularly for Crosshair. So to me, it seems like a good way to indicate it. And then obviously the frozen planet of the outpost was introduced in season 2, and they made, I think, it's literally when hell freezes over. It's that line from Han Solo, right? That outpost is hell frozen over.
Mm.
And you, as a character, have to go back to the underworld, right? Sometimes to see things. But also in the episode, we see Pabu.
Yeah.
Which is that place that they showed where the clones of the Bad Batch learned the idea of potentially a different life, that you could have a family. Like, these are things they didn't even know about. So I feel like, okay, so they intentionally put this planet into the story, this safe place of Pabu. Yeah. And they also have the frozen planet in episode 5 that's this hell frozen over. And the ice vulture actually comes down.
Yes.
Yeah.
And like rests. It actually, I think it lands on one of those markers, right? Part of the perimeter fence thing. So it's like, it's almost trying to tell them, you know, hey, watch out for this thing. But what do you surmise from the vulture coming down and not being in the air anymore?
Well, he's coming down to the line from Mayday is something to the effect of they're vicious survivors.
Oh.
And Crosshair survived, right? So now he has to kind of get past the vicious part that got him to the point of survival. So sometimes you just have to, I guess, you just got to confront the evil that you haven't seen the whole time. And now he's got to return to his humanity. So that's kind of what I feel. You know, like you said, it's like the Morai to Ahsoka, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and then in episode 6,
which is infiltration,
steam. When they go to Chuchi is going to have the meeting, there's steam everywhere, and to me that's overheated. Like the tension is rising. Overheated water. When the clone X, the first clone X, is trying to escape, he's busting steam vents, and I think that's, to me, says this is about the situation they're in. There's a lot of tension. There's a lot of energy in the moment. And, you know, we have two big power players, back to the separatists and now people from Coruscant talking about having a revolution. It's a high tension situation, and steam is high tension.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It denotes high tension anyway. Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't even notice that. Wow.
And then,
but water is all over extraction.
All over. All over. And then we have a waterfall
mm-hmm.
in that becomes very evident as this last episode happens, episode 7, and you're like, waterfall. So when I got to that, I'm like, wait, we are just way too much water going on in these episodes. And then there's a fight in the waterfall and people are falling down waterfalls. So what do you think about the waterfall?
Okay. So the waterfall, well, to me, I mean, the very fact, like, isn't on the edge of the waterfall where the clones, both ships faced off against each other? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you had the waterfall backdrop right there. Trying to think what that means. But for me, what really spoke to me in this episode was the fact that the Clone X and Crosshair were having that fight in the water of the waterfall, and they were falling down first one and then another. It's like they had to lower themselves to the base level of being a human to get out of this situation, right? But then at one point, you know, Clone X gets the upper hand and is drowning Crosshair in the water. Like, you see Crosshair, that, what a horrific image, like Crosshair's face in the water, like that, like, and then you can tell he like stops breathing. And in this moment, I felt, you know, how we talk about baptism a lot in water, and that's what you have to do to be baptized, is like either water's poured on you or you actually physically immerse yourself in water. And so I don't think necessarily Crosshair was baptized in that moment, but one of the clones who comes and saves him from the water, like the clones have to physically walk into the water to save him from the Clone X. And I feel like that was almost signifying that they have finally forgiven Crosshair, or, you know, at least see him as part of their own, in my opinion.
Yeah, so, yeah, absolutely. There's, to me, watching it again, I still feel like there's one moment where that Clone X operative, he sees Crosshair like dying, because it's not like it's not an impersonal killing, right?
No, he's right there.
Not with the helmets on, not against a droid. I think there's a moment where he almost pauses, like, I think I've killed him, and it seems like there's body language, like, for a second, and then you see right away that, you know, they're coming to his rescue, that they're not leaving him behind. Maybe I'm reading that into it, but that's still where I go, well, I think this person's supposed to be somebody. I do have a long conversation with BJ on Hyperspace Theories about the episode where Tech dies and the way that other storytelling elements play out that suggests that Tech could have survived because of the way they treat the other characters and how they are, their lives are put in peril. But then when the Clone X drops off the waterfall and then we see he doesn't die, I'm like, what does that mean? So I did go up and look, what do waterfalls mean in storytelling? And because this is something you do as a writer, right? You look at things and what are the different meanings. One of the things that waterfalls mean, and not even applying it for, could it be Tech? This is the conversation of, could it be Cody or could it be a clone across here? Is waterfall suggest hidden secret things, hidden truths. And we have this great kind of moment in that between Crosshair and the Clone X, and Clone X doesn't die. So I was kind of like, okay, that's interesting. I don't know what we can make of it, but.
So to you, it says hidden secret meaning behind perhaps Clone X.
Yeah.
Okay. I like that. And that makes sense because, you know, waterfalls often have like a secret cave behind it and so many movies and things like that.
And it's all about the storytelling. Half of the fun is just sussing things out and where they could be and not being too wedded to where they could go. So that's why we're just talking about them. And when we get further down, we could go, oh, yeah, Tricia totally overread the hidden meaning of the waterfall. Or maybe Tricia was onto something about water in general. But yes. I don't know.
But one of the things I am a little sad about is that when Wolf arrived and he saw the waterfall, he didn't say, "Hey, look, it's the backside of water."
It's such a Disney joke.
It is. All right, I couldn't help myself.
You couldn't. So, Sarah, I do want to talk about music because you always have insights, and I just absorb the music and you digest it and point out amazing things to me.
Okay. Yeah. So I've been waiting to talk about this one, but in episode 4, which is when it's a different approach. So this is when Omega and Crosshair, you know, shoot their way out of the spaceport. And then this is another Return of the Jedi crossover moment. Okay. You ready for this?
Yes.
Okay. So for the first 3 episodes of this season, you never hear the Bad Batch theme anywhere within the soundtrack. You hear it at the end over the credits, but that doesn't count. So when Omega finally reunites with Hunter and Wrecker at the end of episode 4, you hear this amazing, tear-inducing, dramatic version of the B part of the Bad Batch theme. And a lot of people call this Omega's theme, but it's all rolled into the Bad Batch theme. It's kind of like how the Star Wars theme is like Luke's theme, right? It's kind of rolled into that. So this is again mimicking Return of the Jedi, because for the first like 20, 25 minutes of this movie, when they're in Jabba's palace and all of that, you never hear the Star Wars theme until you have, you know, they're at the sail barge and it's all tension and Luke is finally made to jump off the plank, and that's when R2, you know, shoots him his lightsaber and he grabs it out of the air and does that flip. That is when you hear an amazing version of the Luke Skywalker Star Wars theme. And then that begins the whole, you know, sail barge battle. And so it's this huge release of built up tension and excitement. And that happens, you know, in both these properties, you know, Return of the Jedi and Bad Batch Season 3. Thought that was cool.
We missed you, kitty. We never stopped searching. But how did you escape?
I had help.
They know how to work the heartstrings, whether it's to tell us this is the really exciting part. I know it's been kind of going and you're not sure, but now we're into the good stuff. In either case, Return of the Jedi, sail barge, or here when you're like, okay, they're back together. Now we're going to get into the meat.
Now we get the whole theme. Oh, it's so cool. Yeah. So it was really neat how the Kyners like resisted using that theme until you had the Bad Batch back together. It was really cool. All right. So then I want to talk about another of those themes that we're getting in this season, which is the nature versus technology. And we talked about that, how on Mount Tantus, it's a very, the theme of Mount Tantus that you hear is all synthesized. Right. And you only have instrumentals, true instruments, when you have emotional moments. Well, here, Clone X has kind of a theme, or not really even, I don't even want to call it a theme. I want to call it like a sound, because that's what it is. So whenever we see Clone X on the screen, you hear this low synth and electronic music beats. It's usually like 2 or 3 beats. It's not a full theme. It just evokes danger, almost like the Jaws theme a little bit. And there's a really good point at about 12 minutes in the episode Extraction. I'll play for you right here. So you can tell that it's just all synths. There's no instrument to it. There's no really theme to it. He is just a tool to be used. It almost sounds like a hammer, kind of like knocking. That's what the Clone X is for. They're just tools of the Empire.
It's like so cool, because like to me, that it isn't even something that sticks out. I'm obviously, you know, it's working on me in a way, but it's like you're pointing it out and I'm like, oh my God, like it's so true. Like just the way that the music in Star Wars informs so much of what you're experiencing in the story itself. I'm like, that's totally cool. I mean, I can say I understand and see the nature versus technology, but in the music itself, like that you're just picking it up, you're like, I'm like, so cool.
Yeah, you just hear it. It's amazing. And once again, like in that whole extraction, when they're going down the spire and they're in the waterfall and stuff, it's like full instrumental, you know, because this is big. This is big things happening. Characters are changing. Characters are realigning. And there's lots of action. So you get that full instrumental. But whenever you just see Clone X on the screen, you hear that synth tone. It's crazy. So then I want to get to the end of Extraction. And this is when Rex returns to their mission, which is Tantus, right? And so Rex is talking to the other clones and he's saying, you need to figure out why Omega is so important to them at Tantus in order to really be able to extract the clones or save Omega, keep Omega safe, right? And over his talking about this, we hear the Omega, like Tantus clock theme. It returns over the top of the music. So remember when I was talking about in episode one, especially, you hear that like kind of clockwork Tantus theme. That's what I'm calling it. The clockwork Tantus theme. That synthesizer note is very high.
Yeah, that totally drives the kind of the tension and the drama,
yeah,
of those, you know, ending those episodes. It's like, ooh.
Mm-hmm. So it returns right there, right when they're talking about Omega and Tantus.
You need to find out why she's so important to them.
Kiner's a genius, and now he's gets to, you know, it's a family affair, and they get to drive all these things home. Incredible. And I feel like we're now at a point where it's like, yeah, Hunter, you better think about this, which is what Rex is saying in that moment. Like, you better think about the choices you're making.
And
poor Hunter's, he's the one who doesn't have a purpose yet. Everything in him is reactionary to protect
family.
Omega, protect the Bad Batch, protect Omega. He's the one who's struggling the most in all this.
Like, I think Omega? So, because even Omega is all like, we got to save our brothers, you know, we got to save those clones on Tantus. Like she has single-minded.
Hunter wants to just go home and go to Pabu and have family. He says, I find little errant clones. I send you to Pabu. I want to go back to Pabu. I want to just be a daddy. And
he's a homebody.
Yeah, he does. He so wants to be a homebody. Poor thing. And then Crosshair is like getting in his Omega daddy space, I think. You know, he's kind of taking that role as well.
I think so. Yeah. It's exciting. I can't wait to see where this goes. We still have yet to see Fennekshand. We still have yet to see Ventress, you know, and these have been promised in the previews. So I'm excited.
I can't appreciate it. It is Women's History Month.
Oh.
Of the timing of being excited about seeing Fennekshand and Asajj Ventress in Women's History Month.
Okay.
So the Asajj Ventress lightsaber special package
released.
Sold out on Disney. It's now Disney Store, not Shop Disney. If I say it wrong, I'm sorry, but it's Disney
fine.
Store again online, but they're gone. They're sold out. There's still some in the parks. I know a few people, Wesley and BJ, who have
They purchased them.
Yeah.
Wesley showed it off on our last things we want to share live on Skywalking. So
did he stick them together?
Yeah.
Yeah,
he did. And he couldn't get far enough away from the screen to show it because it's so gigantic.
They're so cool. And it's so cool to me. I mean, I know people collect things and they're going to get lightsabers, but that ASAJJ Ventress, who hasn't even showed up, they're gone from the, you know, because people think, oh, like Cal Kestis's lightsaber is gone and sold out in a flash. But if I'm pondering, because I think there's this 4,500 in that set and they did 1,350 in each of the park versions. Okay. So that's 2,700. They typically, I think they might be holding some back for celebration.
Okay. Okay.
I'm thinking possibly.
That would be fun. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. The box is beautiful. It's $400, but you get a lot to it.
It's a nod to ASAJJ Ventress's original iteration in the Gendi.
Oh, Gendi Tartakovsky? It is?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
The boxes or the sabers? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Wow, that's awesome. That's a deep cut. Well, speaking of the parks, should we tease something? Okay. So I'm so excited because Season of the Force is coming back to Disneyland. I think it only happened in 2015 where Tomorrowland kind of changed over into Star Wars Land before Galaxy's Edge was a thing. And you would walk into Tomorrowland and be just awash in Star Wars soundtrack. I loved it so much. And also, Star Tours is getting an update at the Disney parks. So let's go through what's happening. So beginning on April 5th, all the Star Tours around the world, including Disneyland, Walt Disney World, and I believe Disneyland Paris, are going to get this update. So you're going to have characters and locations from Ahsoka, Andor, and The Mandalorian being added to the whole thing. So you're going to have over like 250 permutations of possible experiences at Star Tours. And the teaser we saw shows you flying through a herd of Purrgil in space.
That was like a no-brainer.
Yeah, totally no-brainer. But they also confirmed that one of the locations that you're going to go to is the planet Peridia from Ahsoka. So I'm wondering if you're going to be swallowed by a Purrgil and head to Peridia, right? And he spit you out on Peridia.
I want to hear our 3PO's reaction to it. I'm in a different galaxy.
Yeah, no kidding. Oh my God, that would be so funny. And then, Tricia, okay, there's going to be new transmissions from Cassian Andor, Din Djarin and Grogu, and Ahsoka. So, lady, we need to ride this and hope that we are picked half and half again as the rebel spy so that Ahsoka can call us out.
Ahsoka or Din or Grogu, yeah. I'd take any of them. Cassian, I would too.
Yeah. But Ahsoka would be my number one. I'd be like, oh, Ahsoka.
I'm like very excited for an update.
Yeah.
So
I'm excited.
I felt like the sequel trilogy versions were kind of uninspired.
I really liked the Last Jedi one because it was a nod to the original Star Tours because you went through that pain of rock glass, shards of glass, like you did the meteor. Right? In the original. So that was cool. And I had the Vault-Tex foxes.
The one that you suck under the water.
That one, I have to close my eyes. The Dianogas in the water.
That one's kind of like,
But I have to close my eyes because it makes me woozy.
Yeah. My favorite version is getting Han Solo retreating in the Millennium Falcon, going to Hoth, and then I'll take the Revenge of the Sith.
You like that one?
The space kind of, it's not really, but it's the space flying through all the spaceships. That's like my favorite version, and give me a good Leia transmission. And I've had that one several times. I feel like when I think really hard, it manifests for me. So you guys, when you go on the ride, just like think really hard. I want to see Ahsoka, and she'll show up.
I love Yoda's transmission. Always gets me kind of teary. And the Naboo ending is my favorite because you you land on Naboo and you end up in that garage with a one of those Naboo. It's like the best ending. Everyone thinks and that
there's multiple versions of that one too.
Oh, really?
Occasionally you can actually run into Jar Jar underwater.
Really?
Yeah. Instead of him just like
swimming away.
It like runs into him. And then there's a couple different versions of, you know, the where you come up and what happens with the little droids. So I don't know if they play all those anymore, but there were, you know, back in the day when which is why I like Seasons of the Force, because I like Star Wars Weekends. And when it was Star Wars Weekends, I would ride it over and over and over again, and you would get
all the things
were different all the time. I do like actually flying in when you get to fly into Batuu. I think that's really cool.
That is fun.
Batuu.
Okay, so what's your limit on how many times in a row can you go? Have you figured that out yet?
I think it was 8 times in a row.
Wow.
And what was happening was South Florida or Central Florida weather, it was lightning and thunderstorming. And instead of making us go outside, they would just let you go back in. And there was obviously nobody coming in.
Yes.
And I got to 8 rides. And I did get to Rebel Spy at one point because people were dropping.
Yes.
There is a limit for some people.
6 is my limit. It gets woozy. Yeah. Like when they had the AP, like, you know, you could ride it over and over as a preview, AP previews. Yeah, that 6 was my limit. I started to get
woozy. Could see people start like, oh, my brain's not doing the, it can't understand why this is happening to me.
Yeah. So I'm excited. So that change is happening like forever. So Star Tours will be updated until they update it again. So you'll get that. But Season of the Force is only happening at Disneyland beginning April 5th. And running through June 2nd. And let's see. So Hyperspace Mountain is returning, which is the best overlay of Space Mountain ever.
Ever.
Ever. They're going to have special merchandise, food, and beverage, of course, right? I hope we get the shake that's, I think, is it at Hollywood Studios right now where it's a Leia shake?
Yes, with the cinnamon cinnamon rolls as her cinnamon. And from what I've seen, everybody says cinnamon rolls are but the shake's good.
Okay, well, that's cool. But this is the best part. So in Disneyland, Galaxy's Edge is situated at the back of the park. The fireworks that they use for, like, you know, projecting in front of the castle, they are huge because they're literally being shot off right behind Galaxy's Edge. And it's fun to watch the fireworks over the spires and over the Millennium Falcon, but there's never any music. Like, you don't get the music that you get if you're standing in front of the castle or on Main Street. Well, for Season of the Force, they are going to have, I guess, Star Wars music during the fireworks. And I am excited.
I'm excited to see it with you.
Yeah. So April 5th, we are both going to be there checking out Season of the Force. Yay, Trisha's coming to my hood.
Yay, it's going to be a Disneyland kind of month. You know what? I love Walt Disney World, but there's something about Disneyland that's just so much fun. And from what I've heard people, if you do go to Disneyland, if you go to the Grand Californian Bar, which I think is called the Hearthstone Bar.
Yes, Hearthstone. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There is a secret menu and you can get lightsaber drinks.
Whoa. Well, we'll need to check that out when you're here.
A red one and a blue one.
Aww.
So that is one of the things I'm going to check out. But I saw that recently. I was like, whoa, wait a minute. Lightsaber drinks? I'm all for it.
Me too. All right. Woo. Well, that brings us to an end of this Fangirls Going Rogue. We hope you guys enjoyed it. I know I always learn so much talking to you, Tricia. So thank you.
You got a plug? Do you have anything to plug?
Oh, to plug? Oh my gosh. Well, why don't you start with your plugs? And I'll think of some plugs while you go.
Sarah slacked on putting your plugs in the show notes, but that's okay. Always for a good plug. So if you haven't listened to the Three Bad Batch interviews that we got to do. So Michelle Ang, the voice of Omega. We also got to speak to Dee Bradley Baker, which is, to me, I've interviewed him a few times now at this point over all the years. And it was one of my favorite Dee Bradley Baker interviews because of, I think that he feels the weight of ending the story with the clones. And then also with the showrunners, Jennifer Corbett and Brad Rouse. So if you haven't listened to those, they're still timely. Because sometimes we have to ask questions and nobody's seen anything. So I like listening to them after we've seen stuff. Mm. And then Hyperspace Theories, the end of the Bad Batch season 2. Quite a bit of stuff that, having seen season 3, that we kind of sussed around knowing things. So it almost feels like sometimes exploring storytelling stuff way later is useful. And we had broken down the beginning of season 2 in a couple different episodes, so we have a new one with the end of the Bad Batch season 2 discussion, and then also discussion on Echo and What If that talks about the way that we're seeing the story of a hero involved, this idea of not seeing a conquering hero as opposed to seeing these kind of nurturing heroes, which classically people think Luke Skywalker, Jedi, conqueror, but his triumphant moment is actually laying down his lightsaber. So I do think that Luke Skywalker is one of the first iterations of this in big film instead of, and a lot of people
have such said, a powerful moment.
Yeah. And Harry Potter, a lot of people say he's kind of framed that way too, but we're seeing it kind of stronger in storytelling, and Echo really works on it. And that conversation will dovetail into a future, the Marvels discussion on that we're going to do. I don't care what anybody says, that is one of my favorite movies.
It's so
fun. I think people are seeing it now and going, I don't know why I listened to anybody who said I shouldn't go see it. And it will dovetail into discussion about what's happening with Omega, which I haven't really kind of, it's not done yet, so I can't really discuss it, but it's things that I'm seeing. She's having some of the same kind of beats into it. Yeah. And then if you haven't seen Netflix's Damsel with Millie Bobby Brown, who I think should be cast as Leia Organa in future stories, she would be perfect. I watched that, enjoyed it. It's not perfect, but for a Netflix movie, it's pretty good and picks up on the same type of beat. So if you enjoy things in Echo, you enjoy things in What If. If you're enjoying things with Omega, I think we're seeing these things pick up over and over again, storytelling. So Hyperspace Theories, go to Fangirl Blog and you can check those out.
Awesome. Well, I have I have two plugs. So one of them is, you know, it was just my birthday and I was born in March of 1981. And Richard and I, for the past 9 years, have been going through the classic Marvel Star Wars comics, which came out from like 1978, I want to say, through 1986. Well, we just came to the March 1981 issue. And it's my birthday issue, and it is Leia versus Darth Vader, and it's so fun.
It's kind of like when you look at the paper with the headline, but this is the comic version.
Yeah, it's really cool. So I'm excited about that. And then also, Richard and I have now broken off, like, in Skywalking Through Neverland, we always have this segment that's called Things We Want to Share. And it's kind of, it's very topical for that week, like what we've done that week or what we've gotten or things to discuss, news of the week, whatever it is. And so we've broken that off now into its own live show every week. Mostly it's going to be Mondays at 6 p.m. Pacific, but it changes sometimes depending on our schedule because we have a fluctuating schedule. But that's always live. You guys are welcome to come watch us and chat. And even if you had something that happened that week and want to come on for 5 minutes and say it, you're welcome to come on. So it's a really fun live stream that you can interact with the community.
Fun. And as always, we're still having our Fangirls Going Rogue Zoom chats. The schedule's up on Fangirls Going Rogue. I think we're at March 25th for that one. 8 p.m. Eastern time, 5 p.m. Pacific time. So every other week, essentially, leading up until the end of the Bad Batch, which will end up in May.
So to find us in between shows, if you're not, or even if you are joining the chat, you can also visit us over at fangirlsgoingrogue.com. We are also on all the socials as at FGGoingRogue. Trisha is at FangirlCantina, and I am at JediTink.
You can send us email, contact at fangirlsgoingrogue.com. Tell us what you think. Who is Clone X Operative?
Who?
We want to know. It?
And what do waterfalls mean to you? And you can find us on Facebook. Just search Fangirls Going Rogue. You can like our page and request to join the group. Just answer the questions that pop up.
And please go to Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review. We need your reviews so more people can find us.
So until next time, do 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 do. Yub.
Yub. Yub.
Yub. This site is not affiliated in any way with Lucasfilm Limited, LLC, the Walt Disney Company, or any of their affiliates or subsidiaries.
Yep, yep.
Let's do that. Do you want to welcome everyone?
I'm going to do it. I'm ready. I got it.
Let's do it. Okay.
Welcome to a new episode of Hyperspace Theories. I'm Tricia Barr from Fangirl Blog, one of your co-hosts, and with me is Sarah Woloski, one of my best friends in the force. Hi, Sarah.
Hi, this would be really awesome. Am I on Hyperspace Theories this week?
Shit, did I just say that?
Yes, you did.
Thanks. No, okay, true story. With The recording kept crapping out, and I had to do it like 10 times for our last Hyperspace series. So that's why it's in my brain. All right, here we go. We're going to try again. Clap again.
I'm going to cry.
I know. Crosshair, the grumpy bald vulture, is making us all sobby.
This site is not affiliated. Oh, no. I can't say that word. I can't say it.
It's horrible. It's a horrible word.
Yep, yep.